Welcome everyone, and thank you for joining us today. My name is Arturo Núñez. I am the manager of Mistras Substation Reliability Center of Excellence, and I will be one of your moderators of this webcast entitled, How to Maximize Transformer Reliability and In-Market Availability. Today, we'll be talking about the value of a comprehensive transformer reliability program can add to your operations. We'll be looking at various methods of dissolved gas analysis and acoustic emission testing, their applications and advantages. And then we'll answer some of the questions that some of you submitted after registration. With me is Dr. Michel Duval. Dr. Duval is an internationally renowned leader in the field of dissolved gas analysis for transformer condition monitoring. He is the creator of the Duval triangles and pentagons, DGA methods that continue to be used worldwide. Dr. Duval is a fellow of both the IEEE and the Chemical Institute of Canada, and has worked as a senior research scientist at the Hydro-Québec Institute of Research in Quebec, Canada. Today, Dr. Duval will be speaking about DGA diagnosis methods, fault types that are detectable by DGA, and applications of the Duval triangles and pentagons. Please welcome our keynote speaker, Dr. Michel Duval.
Transformers are very reliable pieces of electrical equipment. However, in a very small number of cases, catastrophic failures may occur. If these failures were not anticipated, they may have huge financial consequences in terms of damage, lost revenues, and penalties. Several tools are available to monitor the condition of transformers. However, for the early detection of failures and faults, the monitoring tool most widely used is dissolved gas analysis, or DGA. There are several DGA diagnosis methods available using either 1, 2, 3, 4, or 5 hydrocarbon gases at a time, for instance, in the triangle and pentagon methods. Carbon oxides and furans are then used to confirm the diagnosis provided by hydrocarbon gases as to whether paper is involved in faults or not. Six basic types of faults are detectable by DGA: corona partial discharges PD, low energy discharges D1, high energy discharges D2, and thermal faults T1, T2, T3 of different temperatures. They are detectable, for instance, with triangle 1 and pentagon 1. Then there are 4 additional subtypes of thermal faults which are detectable with triangles 4, 5, and pentagon 2. Stray gassing of oil S below 200 centigrade, overheating O of oil or paper below 250 centigrade, high temperature hotspots T3, T2 in oil only, also called faults T3H. These 3 subtypes of thermal faults are of minor concern in transformers because they are either in oil only or they do not result in carbonization of paper. Finally, fault C, with possible carbonization of paper, which are potentially more dangerous because of the loss of insulating properties of paper when it is carbonized. This is triangle 1, using methane, CH4, ethylene, C2H4, and acetylene C2H2. Triangle 1 is useful to distinguish between the 6 basic types of electrical and thermal faults. Pentagon 1 is also able to identify the 6 basic types of fault plus stray gassing of oil S. Pentagon 1 uses all 5 hydrocarbon gases, hydrogen H2, ethane C2H6, methane ethylene and acetylene. Triangle 4 allows to identify three of the subtypes of thermal faults of lesser concern, faults S, O, and corona PD. Triangle 4 uses hydrogen, methane, and ethane, which are the so-called low-temperature gases. Triangle 5 allows to distinguish between high-temperature faults in oil only, of lesser concern, and those with possible carbonization of paper, C, potentially more dangerous. Triangle 5 uses methane, ethylene, and ethane, the so-called high-temperature gases or hot metal gases. Pentagon 2 allows to identify the three basic electrical faults, PD, D1, D2, and the three subtypes of thermal faults, S, O, T3 in oil or T3H, and C. Pentagon 2 uses the same five gases as Pentagon 1. Most faults observed in transformers in service are thermal faults in more than 90% of cases. High temperature faults T3, T2 in oil only, or T3H, occur in 28% of cases. Stray gassing of oil S, 20%, overheating O, 9%. So, in the majority of cases, gas formation in transformers is not a very big concern. Then, hotspots with possible carbonization of paper, 12%, arcing D1, D2, not more than one or a few percent, and corona partial discharges, PD, in only 0.3% of cases. When TGA indicates a high temperature fault T3, T2, T3 in oil, C, or electrical discharges D1, complementary acoustic tests may be very useful. First, to find the location of the fault, provided it is not inside the windings or core, and second, to confirm whether the fault is in oil only and therefore not too much of a concern, or it may involve carbonization of paper or discharges and is potentially dangerous for the transformer. I would like now to send the presentation back over to Arturo. As he mentioned, Arturo is the manager of Mistras Group's Substation Reliability Center of Excellence, which develops instrumentation and applications to diagnose and monitor power equipment using non-invasive techniques. He is a certified level 3 in acoustic emission, and he was the principal investigator on a research project with the Electrical Power Research Institute, EPRI, that introduced a new acoustic emission technique for the detection and location of gassing sources in power transformers and tap changers. Today, Arturo will be speaking about the importance of maximizing transformer reliability and how to extend your assets' lifespan using acoustic emission testing.
Thank you, Dr. Duval. I'm going to be talking to you about some of the techniques that can be applied on-site for the evaluation of the integrity of power transformers. As you know, we have different sizes of power transformers. We have small units that we can call distribution transformers. We also have medium-sized units, such as transmission transformers, all the way to big units, several hundred MVA generator step-up transformers. All these techniques intend to prevent catastrophic failures, as the one shown here on the photograph. We're trying to detect the faults well before they get to an advanced level, and we try to do that with different techniques applied online. As you unfortunately probably know, there are a lot of consequences due to catastrophic failure in a power transformer. Some of the consequences are, if it's a GSU transformer, you might have a plant shutdown if you don't have an spare on site. If you know that you have a problem, you have to wait up to 3 years to get the new transformer or the spare transformer in site. The capital cost for a failure is significant, several millions of dollars. You might have to do a lot of adjustment just to cover for the transformer that you lost. There might be a loss of revenue, and there's going to be a negative impact on the profit for the utility. And in case there is a fire or an oil spillage, you might have a EPA fine or even legal action for some of the users that are not receiving the electrical energy. One of the techniques I'm going to be talking to you about is acoustic emission. Acoustic emission has been around since the 50s. It has been used for mechanical evaluation of structures, looking for cracks, corrosion. In power transformers, it has been used since the 70s. It was applied by Westinghouse during induced voltage tests, and has been evolving since. The way it works is as follows. Here we're looking at the top view of a transformer. Remember, we do this test with the transformer in service, which is one of the advantages of the technique. The sensors are installed with magnets on the four walls of the transformer, always working within the safe distance for the electric clearances on the transformer. We have an acoustic emission instrument, such like this. We have cables from the sensor to the instrument. And the way it works, we're listening to whatever is happening on the unit. If there is an active fault on the transformer, the fault is going to produce a sound. The sound is going to travel from wherever it's located to the tank wall. As soon as the pressure wave hits the tank wall, we're actually going to see the electrical signal produced by that fault. We know the position of the sensors. We know the size of the transformer and the velocity of propagation of the sound. And with that information, we can actually triangulate and locate the fault. This is normalized. We have ASTM standards that talk about frequency to be used, type of sensors, etc. But most importantly for us, we have an IEEE standard, C57127. This is an active standard. It's not a mandatory standard. It's just a guideline. Please note that this standard only talks about partial discharge. It doesn't talk about other types of defects that you can find. This is a standard that is being reviewed, and we are part of that review committee. If you remember on the previous slide, we put up to 24 sensors on the transformers. For every single sensor, we actually collect a lot of features. We call it acoustic emission features, such as this. It can be duration, energy, amplitude, a number of counts, etc. This information is used in order to characterize different defects. You might have an electrical fault, high temperature fault, or a mechanical defect. They have different features, and that's how we can characterize them. Basically, we have three different solutions depending on the size of the transformer. The first one is for transformers that are smaller than 10 MVA. We can do multiple tests per day. The next step will be a diagnostic test, which is typically 24-hour test. And it's 24 hours because we want to have all the load changes, the temperature changes, and operating changes during that period of time. This is applied for power transformers that are several hundred MVAs. It can be a transmission transformer or generator step-up transformer. And if you have a critical unit or a fault that is active, we can actually do continuous monitoring with this instrument. For either package screening, diagnostic, or online monitoring, we use a number of techniques. The techniques that we use are acoustic emission, vibration, dissolved gas analysis, oil quality, infrared inspection, and electrical detection. And I'm going to explain you a little bit of each in the following slides. Okay, so the first test will be acoustic emission. For a screening test, small transformers, we use a portable instrument like this. We can add an electrical detection sensor or high frequency CT or Rogowski coil. And this sensor is looking for partial discharge that is detected through the ground cable on the transformer. We take measurement on one location, then move the acoustic sensor to a different point. For each point, we ended up having a layout like this, showing the position where the measurement was taken. We can repeat the same test every 6 months or every year and start looking for trends that can identify a problem. Along with acoustic emission, the next test will be vibration. Vibration is used to look for mechanical defects. We can look at loose components on the transformer, loose core clamping, or loose sheathing, for example. We also take measurements at different points. And at the end, we have a layout showing all the measurements. We know where we took the measurements, and we can compare that over time. We complement that with infrared inspection. As you know, infrared can be used for looking for problems with the cooling system. We can look at low oil levels. You can see a sludge, for example, on the bottom of the transformer, or you can see overheating of tap changer compartments. That might indicate contact damage or contact degradation. An optional test will be an audible sound measurement. If you utilities have complaints that the transformer is too noisy at night, we can do a test to characterize what frequencies the noise is coming from and under what conditions, and that can help remediate the problem. Finally, the other tests are dissolved gas analysis or oil quality. For oil quality, we use C57-1 CIS standard, and for DGA, we use C57-104. That was the explanation for screening testing. If we go with the next two steps, which is diagnostic testing and online monitoring, this is the typical setup. We have the sensors on the transformer on the four walls of the unit. These sensors are installed in service. We have magnetic temperature sensors, clamp-on CTs for load current, tap changer current, pump current, and we also add a high-frequency CT that is connected either to the tank ground or the neutral ground connection. All this installation is done approximately 4 to 6 hours, so it's a very fast installation process. What you will get at the end of a monitoring is something like this. One representation is two dimensions. One, in that drawing, we can actually overlay the drawing of the transformer. If there is an active fault, it's going to be shown on as a red dot. If you have a concentration of dots, we call that a cluster. That is typically a fault that is located on the transformer. In this case, you can see it's on the lower right corner. If you have photographs or you have been inside the transformer, you know what component is there, and you can take decisions accordingly. The other representation is three-dimensional location, where you can actually see the coil and the core, and the red dots again indicate the fault, and you have a good idea where it's coming from on the unit. Once we collect the data, we do some data analysis. The first step is to remove the noise. The noise can be environmental, wind, rain, snow, or it can be operational. It can be core noise, pump noise, tap changer operations. Once we remove the noise, we have the fault information. We correlate that with operating parameters. And if we have photographs or drawings, we can actually see what component is located at that in that part of the transformer and try to understand what is happening and what is the acoustic emission coming from. This is an example of correlation. Here you can see this is a tap changer operation in blue, and in red you have the lower positions. At the beginning of this data, there is no activity. Suddenly, when the tap changer changed to position 1R, the fault was active, and we saw that behavior over time. The recommendation was to not operate the tap changer on odd positions. This doesn't solve the problem. However, it gives the utility some time to plan what is the next step. In the recent developments with this acoustic emission technique, we have a project since 2001 with EPRI. The reason for the project was the industry believed that only electrical faults could be detected with acoustic emission. However, we have a number of tests where non-electrical problems were also detected. After this program, we were able to prove that high temperature faults and mechanical faults can also be detected with acoustic emission. And we also develop a grading system. A and B is normal operation out of the 1,500 tests we have done. C is an incipient fault, and D is an active fault. Just to give you an idea of distribution, out of the 1,500 tests, only 60% had been A or B, 3% have been incipient faults, and only 10% have been active faults. Out of that 10%, we actually have two catastrophic failures a few months after the test was done. So I'm going to show you one of those case studies next. The other product that we have out of the research project is an instrument for continuous acoustic monitoring, which is called Sensor Highway. You can see the sensor, the instrument here is basically an NEMA cabinet. It can host up to 16 acoustic emission sensors, and we can have up to 16 additional signals, either 4 to 20 milliamps or 0 to 10 volts. This instrument is doing is basically monitoring continuously the transformer, is collecting data 24/7. A few times a day, it sends data to an FTP site. With that data, we actually populate a website. Basically, the end user can log in and look at the data anytime they want. They can see operating information, but they can also see the location of the fault if there is an active fault. This instrument has communications. It can be connected via an Ethernet cable, or it can have a cell phone modem. The information that is provided can be displayed on a web page, as you can see on this slide. If there is an alarm, for example, a Buchholz alarm or any other alarm, we can actually connect remotely to the system and see what is happening in real time. If there is a desire to integrate information to the utilities data center, we can also do that via OPC or Modbus. And next, I'm going to show you some case studies so you can see the practical application for these techniques. The first case study is a transformer we did in South America. This is a transformer that is 160 MVA, built in 1996, core for transformer. You can see the photograph there. This transformer, we did a test because the transformer started gas in February 2010. Here you can see the DGA. As you can see, the main gas on this DGA is ethane. Ethane indicates a low temperature fault on the transformer. When applying the Duval triangle, we can see that the fault started on low temperature fault, T1, and it moved to a medium temperature, T2. Using the Pentagon 2, we can see that the fault at the beginning was stray gassing, and later it evolved to an overheating. We did acoustic emission tests on this unit, and this is what we found. Basically, you can see here, I'm going to show you this in detail in a few slides, but you can see the acoustic activity was detected on the upper part of the phase U coil. What is important to mention here, you can see the test was done in June. At that point, the gases were relatively low. On that condition, the utility decided to keep the transformer in service. A few months later, as you can see, the gases spike, increase significantly, and at that point, the utility decided to take an outage and do an internal inspection. Before the internal inspection, they look at the acoustic report, and this is what they found. We correlate activity to phase U. Looking at the front view, you can see that everything was on the upper part of the coil. So they knew where to look for the problem during the internal inspection. Before opening the transformer, they tested the oil. The oil tested positive for corrosive sulfur. As you probably know, corrosive sulfur attacks copper, especially on paper insulated windings. This transformer was special in a sense that instead of having paper as insulation, it has varnish. Therefore, the varnish protects the winding from being attacked from corrosive sulfur. However, you can see when they open the transformer, they look at the location we provide, and they found some damage, a turn-to-turn failure on the winding. After doing the investigation, what they found is that during manufacturing, the manufacturer actually welded two coils at that location. After doing the weld, instead of putting paper as insulation, they didn't put any varnish on top of that. So the paper was not protected, the copper was not protected. And what you are seeing on the photograph is the damage of the corrosive sulfur, the attack of the corrosive sulfur on the winding. They did electrical testing, and they also saw that the phase U resistance was higher, 66.86 milliohms. And on the right, you can see a closer view of the weld that they inspected, confirming that it was a corrosive sulfur attack. Some of the benefits for the end user here were we were able to provide early detection. Even when the DGA gassing trend was low, we were still able to pinpoint the location of the source. Once they knew that there was a problem on that unit, they actually prevented anybody to get close to the transformer, therefore increasing the safety for the personnel. And they knew that they have a potential issue and they have a plan in place in case there was a failure on the unit. The second case is on a much bigger transformer. This is a ESU transformer for a nuclear plant. Here on the slide, you can see the DGA data. As you can see, for several months, the DGA was relatively stable. However, by the end of 2011, the gases increased. When looking at the DGA data and looking at the Duval Triangle and Pentagon, you can see Duval Triangle number one gave us a diagnosis that was moving from T2 up to all the way to T3, high temperature fault. If we look at triangle 5, we started on a non-determined fault and then moved to a carbonization. And with the Pentagon, we started with overheating and then we moved to carbonization as well. Reviewing the acoustic emission data we collected, we saw that the highest activity was on sensor number 3. Now here, the scenario for this utility was they already knew there was a design problem with this transformer, and the design problem was related to the shielding. So what they wanted to know is if the gassing caused by the same problem or we have a new problem occurring on the transformer. The challenge here is, as you know, nuclear plants, they only go offline every 24 months or 18 months. So they wanted to know if they need to take an emergency outage. The emergency outage is very expensive for these guys. We're talking about $1 million per day. So that decision was not light. When looking at the data after 6 months of monitoring, this is what we saw. You can see the acoustic activity was detected on the wall of the transformer, which is exactly where they knew there was a shielding problem, which was a design problem. Even more interestingly, we actually saw some correlation when the DGA spiked, we also saw a correlation with acoustic emission. So we have a confirmation by the two techniques that something was happening on the unit. The good news for the utility is we confirmed it was the existing problem. Therefore, they didn't need to take an emergency outage. They waited until the scheduled outage for refueling, and then they opened the transformer. When they opened the transformer, this is what they found. As you are seeing here is the shielding, and you can see signs of overheating on the tank wall. So this confirmed that the suspicions were right. It was the known problem, and it was not a problem that was putting the life of the transformer at risk. The solution was adding insulation between the tank wall and the shielding and tightening the bolts and put the transformer back in service. Some of the benefits for this end user were we were able to confirm that it was the known problem. We prevent loss of revenue by confirming that it was the old problem and that it was not something critical. We were able to maintain the transformer in market availability by avoiding an emergency outage of the nuclear plant. So we were able to maintain the unit in service until the scheduled outage. The next case is for a GSU transformer. This is a shell form that has been in service for 20 years. This transformer was in service after that time and suddenly they start gassing. The main gas was ethylene, and the gassing rate was up to 60 parts per million per day. With that gassing rate, they knew they have a problem. So the question for them was, can I open the transformer on site or do I need to ship it to the manufacturer? As you know, a transformer of this size, just the shipping cost, we are talking about $300,000 to $400,000 just for shipping. So it was a decision that they needed to take carefully. They decided to call us to do an acoustic test. We did the test, and this is what we found. As you can see, we found the acoustic source on the upper right corner of the transformer. When looking at the top view, in this case, in this graph, the red indicates the highest intensity of the fault. Everything was concentrated on the X1 bushing. And looking at the front view of the transformer, you can see that everything is on the upper part of the transformer. When they saw that everything was on the upper part of the transformer, they decided to lower the oil and do an internal inspection on site. They went inside, looked at the area where we found activity, and this is what they found. What you are seeing here is the three copper bus bars that are below the X1 bushing, which is where we have the highest intensity. What you are seeing is the carbonization of the bus bar, so you have a high temperature fault on that particular transformer. You can see signs of overheating on the other two bus bars, so this is a matter of time before a catastrophic failure might happen. So they found it on time. When we look at the DGA, we find an excellent correlation. As you can see on the photograph, there is no paper insulation involved. And when looking at the DGA diagnosis, we have a triangle one is telling us we have a high temperature, a thermal fault, on the transformer. Triangle five is between carbonization and high temperature fault on the oil. And pentagon two is telling us we have carbonization, which is what we saw on the internal inspection. Some of the benefits for the end user, we prevented loss of revenue. The alternative, if they have to ship the transformer to the manufacturer, was that the plant was going to be offline for 3 months. Finding the problem and being able to repair the problem on site, the transformer was only offline for a week. So a significant savings there. There was no catastrophic failure, therefore we avoid EPA fines. Also, we avoid any legal action by loss of supplying power to some of the industrial customers. And there was no negative profit impact for this utility. So this case I show you is for a 20-year-old transformer. The next case is going to be for a 4-year-old transformer. This is a 243 MVA single-phase 500 kV transformer. Has been in service for 4 years. The reason why we did this test is, as you can see on the DGA, we have hydrogen at 192 parts per million. This is not a very high number. However, the other two phases were very low, basically zero. So the question was, why is this transformer gassing if we are on the same substation, same load, and is the same design? We ended up doing the test, and this is what we found. You can see the plot is events versus time. Events means when we can correlate the triangulate acoustic activity on the transformer. First, we have no activity during the first 2 hours. After 2 hours, we have the fault active for 1 hour and 13 minutes. Then it went quiet for 3 hours, and then active again for 1.5 hours. So this was a very unusual behavior. We correlate this and found that every time the voltage was higher than a certain value is when the fault was active. To make things more confusing, we ended up having two locations, one on the lower part of the core and the second on the upper part of the core. Sometimes the two sources were active, sometimes only one, and sometimes none. We ended up doing our analysis, the grading system that I show you, and we graded this transformer as a D, high intensity fault. We recommend to take action right away. This transformer was under guarantee, so the utility sent the report to the manufacturer. The recommendation from the manufacturer was to keep it in service. So they decide not to take an outage. They wanted to wait until a few months later when they have a scheduled outage on the transformer. Unfortunately, the transformer failed 2 months after the test. The failure was catastrophic. you remember the location on the previous slide, we have two areas, lower part of the core, upper part of the core, and this is the areas where we actually have the failure of the transformer. You can see on the right, lower part of the core, and on the left, you see the upper part of the core. The investigation revealed that there was a transportation issue when they shipped the transformer from Europe to the U.S. As you know, they put accelerometers that register all the impacts during transportation. The only transformer that had a high impact was this transformer, phase C. So what they believe happened is the ball that holds the laminations together, it has to be perfectly insulated. However, they suspect during the impact during transportation, the insulation was damaged. Once they put it in service, they start having discharges between the ball and the core laminations. The area of damage was growing and growing. The temperature was higher and higher. Eventually, the core laminations were melted, and all the metallic particles went to the tertiary winding, and there was a catastrophic failure that it was a tertiary to ground failure. And unfortunately, this transformer, we couldn't save it. It was under guarantee. The decision was taken to keep it in service. However, as you can see on the plots before, we were able to pinpoint the location of the problem early on. Probably they would have some damage, but not as serious as the damage that they saw 2 months later. In this case, we don't have DGA data because we only have one data point. One data point was at the point of the acoustic test, which the diagnosis, if you remember, the main gas was hydrogen. The diagnosis is partial discharge, but we don't have the data prior to the internal inspection that most likely will have shown a high temperature fault. This is another case. This is the last case. This is a case study for online monitoring. This is a transformer that is relatively slow, this is a 6 MVA transformer. The main gas was ethylene, which indicates a high temperature fault. The challenges for utility were there were no spare on site available, and the transformer was installed next to a river on the East Coast. So the concern was if there was a catastrophic failure, they might have a fire or they might have some oil being spilled. Being the river so close, they were concerned about oil getting into the river and getting a fine from EPA. They decided to monitor the transformer acoustically to see if there was an increase in activity. This plot shows the data for 8 months. You have different graphs here. The important graphs are the green graph is the load current, the yellow is the gas values, and the dark blue is the acoustic activity. When we start the monitoring, we actually find some acoustic emission, but it's minor. When we continue the monitoring, we keep seeing the same area with a few changes in the number of events. Same behavior after several weeks. Suddenly, in July 2008, there was a spike on acoustic emission first that was seen for DGA later, and we see a little bit more events, as you can see on the 3D location plot. At this point, the utility was thinking about taking the transformer offline. However, we were able to connect remotely. We confirmed that something happened the day before, but the phone was no longer active. With that information, they decided to keep the transformer in service. We continue the monitoring, and as you can see, the number of events decreased, but we're still having the same location, same in the next monitoring period, same on the next one, etc. On the last monitoring period, which is December 2008, we actually see a significant increase in DGA, followed by a significant increase in acoustic activity, and you can see the three-dimensional plot. The number of events increased dramatically. When looking at the DGA data, this is where you can see the evolution. Ethylene, when we started the monitoring, we were at 361 parts per million. By the end of the monitoring, we were at 1,020 parts per million. The gassing rate at the beginning was 1.14. The gassing rate at the end was 34.67 parts per million per day. So it is clear that the fault was getting worse and it was evolving. Looking at the DGA data, the diagnosis were with Duval triangle number 1, we have a high temperature fault. With Duval Triangle number 5, we have a high temperature fault. And the Pentagon 2, we have a high temperature fault in the oil. So very the same diagnosis for all of them. This transformer was sent to the manufacturer for inspection because they have sister units and they were trying to understand what was happening. They did all electrical tests, all the electrical tests passed. The only test that didn't pass was the core ground test. So therefore, we were looking for an unintentional core ground on the transformer. They decided to do a teardown. First, they took out the upper core laminations, couldn't find anything. Next, they took out the coils, couldn't find anything. They started removing the bottom laminations and they couldn't see anything. On the very last lamination, this is what they found. What you are looking at is the bottom frame that holds all the laminations together. Those two areas circling white is actually where we have hot metal that was melted on those locations. What we saw is the very last lamination was this. You can see that the lamination was cut unevenly. We believe that happened because the blade during, at the manufacturer was damaged. They didn't replace it on time. They were using a damaged blade. Therefore, the core lamination was cut unevenly. When the load increased on the transformer, the core lamination expanded, therefore touching the core, the bottom frame, and that's where we have the unintentional core ground of the transformer. This case is interesting because this fault is actually deep inside the transformer, but that was confirmed by DGA, and with acoustic emission, we were able to pinpoint the location as well. So the benefits for this is we were able to keep the transformer in service for 8 months. As you know, one of the problems is having to wait for transformers to be delivered. The waiting time goes between 8 months to up to 2 years, depending on the size of the transformer. So by the time they knew there was a problem, they ordered the new transformer. We were still able to keep the new transformer in service, the old transformer in service, waiting for the new one. With those eight extra months of in operation, they were able to pay for the new transformer. There was no catastrophic failure, no contamination on the river. Therefore, we have no EPA fines. We were able to pinpoint the location and maintain the transformer in service. So as you can see, basically we can separate the screening and evaluation on 3 steps. The first step will be a sampling or a screening, where we are trying to see if there is any indication of a problem. Once we see a transformer that is showing signs of degradation, we can proceed with a 24-hour test to get more information, correlation with operating parameters. After we confirm that there is an ongoing problem or this is a very critical unit, but then we can proceed with a 24-hour monitoring service. When can you use acoustic emission? Acoustic emission can be used on new equipment. This can be done during factory testing, during induced voltage tests, during commissioning of new transformers. If you have transformers in service, we can do a screening test to collect the baseline data, identify activity that is abnormal over time. If you have a transformer that is gassing, we can actually help you triangulate and pinpoint the location of the gassing source. Or if you have a transformer that is critical, we can actually continue to do the monitoring, either to make sure that the transformer is not going to fail, or while we are waiting for the spare transformer or new transformer to arrive. So acoustic emission allows to detect, locate, and trend faults in power transformers with equipment in service. With the grading system, we can actually give you an idea of the severity of the fault, and this is backed up by 1,500 tests on the database that we have. And the main benefit, I think, is provide maintenance engineers with a better understanding what is triggering the acoustic activity, and that might help to provide some steps to remediate that problem. And with that, Dr. Duval and I will now open the presentation to questions. Some of the questions that were previously submitted, all the other questions that we're not going to answer right now are going to be answered later on via email. Our first question is this. We actually have two very similar questions, so we put the two questions in one. Do the speakers have experience with online bushing monitoring devices? Can they speak to the device's ability to detect bushing failures prior to their occurrence? We are not experts on bushing monitoring. However, we know there are two basic types of bushing monitoring systems. One is based on power factor measurements, and the other is based on electrical PD, partial discharge detection. The soil gas analysis can also be used as a diagnostic technique. However, this is very challenging due to the oil that the volume in the bushings is very low. In some projects, we have actually put acoustic emission sensors on the turret, on the bushing turret, so we are trying to find defects. The advantage of acoustic emission is that we are not only looking for partial discharge, but we are also looking for high temperature falls and mechanical problems. The power factor approach is unlikely to detect an imminent failure. However, we believe that the soil gas analysis, partial discharge, or acoustic emission can actually provide timely warning when a fall on a bushing is happening. The next question is this. We actually got some DGA data. I have the next values of gases in a transformer. Hydrogen, 17 parts per million, methane, 22, ethylene, 32, ethane, 3.8, and acetylene, 0.3. Can you tell me the diagnosis about this equipment and your impressions about it and recommendations? In this case, the DGA indicates high temperature fault, either by both the Duval triangle and the Pentagon 2. However, we only have one data point, so we will recommend to get more points in order to determine the gassing trend. If the gassing trend is positive, is confirmed, then an acoustic emission test is recommended to try to pinpoint the activity. The next question was, can Mistras use DGA data supplied by the customer? Can real-time information be sent to the load dispatch control center and implemented as alarms? The answer to both questions is yes. We can get the data either from your laboratory or any DGA monitoring system that you have and analyze it. The acoustic emission data can also be displayed on the control room using either a Modbus or OPC communication protocols. So that concludes the question and answer portion of the webcast. Thank you for your questions. We know that a comprehensive transformer reliability program can save costs on repairs and prevent the loss of revenue if a unit were to go offline. In addition, maximizing transformer reliability allows you to avoid EPA fines and legal actions. But most importantly, the types of DGA and non-invasive acoustic emission testing described in this webcast will allow you to detect and locate any faults or failures early enough to remediate them before catastrophic failure. You can not only catch and diagnose the severity of the fault, but also understand what triggered the activity. This alerts you to any other potential problems before they happen, all without requiring the transformer to be shut down. 70% of large power transformers in the U.S. are over 25 years old, which increases the possibility of faults and failures. Transformer Clinic can help you extend those assets' lifespans and allow you to keep your transformers powered on. For more details on Transformer Clinic, please visit transformer.clinic. I would like to thank Dr. Duval for his contribution to this webcast and to thank you all for your attending. On behalf of Mistras Group, I am Arturo Núñez. Have a good day.